everyone for this interesting panel. I try to be very brief and short, so perhaps then you can have some further follow-up questions after that. I'm Chris, I'm a data scientist at Open Knowledge Maps, and I will give a very superficial introduction to the topic of ethics in algorithms. I have prepared a motivational slide, but I think we had enough motivation why we should care in the last 4 minutes or so. But I think on the meta level point of view, we can say that the scrutiny that the public and also lawmakers have for our field, for the industry, for the profession of statisticians, data scientists, is that the scrutiny moved from looking at raw data, data privacy, data security issues, to how the data is used, and for which purposes. Hot topics were filter bubbles, predictive policing, discriminatory hiring processes, things like that. So some people refer to them as algorithmic war stories because they are told in every meetup, in every bar, but actually they are only the tip of the iceberg, and there is a huge number of other use cases that don't get the same attention. So to try to make the debate a bit more simple and to ground it, make two initial statements. Decision-making procedures that contain individual social biases and or cause a redistribution of welfare, or I think in the legal terms it would be a legal effect. Those procedures precede the age of AI. We all know that humans use heuristics, we have certain cognitive biases, our laws contain some unfair measures, but society, in the best case, finds a way to deal with that. And the second point is computers still do what we tell them, and they reproduce the decisions we teach them. Even in some cases, how this happens may be magical. So if you train an algorithm with a data set that contains a certain bias against a minority group, if you do not control for this bias by using some certain novel technique or by debiasing the data set, the algorithmic system that comes from that will reproduce the initial bias. And on the other hand, even if we have things like AlphaGo playing a Go better at humans, it will not start and tell us what to do with climate change, because we cannot formulate the problem of how to win at climate change in the same way we can formalize what the win is at Go. So given that apparently there is nothing special about algorithmic decision-making systems, why should we still talk about them? We can make two characteristics that are specific to algorithmic systems. One is opacity, and the second one is automation. Opacity in this context means that we do not inherently understand all systems that make decisions about us or use our data. Sometimes it's for it's due to business secrecy laws, sometimes it's due to technical complexity, for example, in deep learning systems. The other thing is automation, which means that on the one hand, once the system is in place, it rarely is supervised or has works with any additional human input. And the second one is that today's systems are so scalable, so fast, and it's such a breadth that it simply surpasses our cognitive capacity, so we can only deal with some fringe cases, some very small samples from the whole decision-making procedures. And based on that, that you can classify the literature into two types of objections that you can make. One is efficiency-based objections. The decision itself is inaccurate. The second one is fairness-based objections, when the decisions treat people unfairly. I think in today's context, the efficiency-based objections like prediction problems and bad data are not as interesting, because prediction problems with human behavior will always remain. And bad data can be fixed with more and better data. And I think given the current trend, more data is not really going to be a problem. Fairness-based objections are more interesting. They contain unfair transfers of wealth, arbitrariness problems, and autonomy-based harms. And I will not go into detail into those different classes here, but just an example, into the class of unfair transfers of wealth falls the decision, falls the common saying, if you're not paying, you're the product. This would be an unfair transfer of wealth in this case. So those objections have two direct consequences. The first one is there's a risk of reintroducing long-fought social biases and long-fought dysfunctional social dynamics into highly scalable and opaque systems. And to avoid this scenario, we need to develop methods and implement them, how to hold automated systems accountable the same way we hold humans accountable. And I think the GDPR and other legislations are taking this up. But if we look at one specific example, this is a lot more easier said than done. I think you've heard about the COMPASS system, which in the USA is used to predict recidivism risk for prison inmates. And one NGO, ProPublica, has studied the effects and the outcomes of the system, and it came to the conclusion that it systematically disadvantages African Americans because they receive a higher prediction of recidivism risk than the comparable risk group of white inmates. And a second report in defense of the system stated that there is no systematic difference between black and white people. And the thing, the interesting thing is that both reports are correct. And, oh, the slides have shifted a bit. there was a paper that has shown that except for very special cases, it is not possible to satisfy both fairness conditions at the same time. Either we achieve the same accuracy for both groups, which is would be the upper case, or we achieve proper treatment of individuals that fall into the same class. Here, for example, the difference was between black and white, medium to high risk inmates. And what they found out is that both conditions of fairness can only be achieved if the base rates for the different groups are similar. And because this is rarely the case in most real-world settings, we will not achieve fairness of all fairness in all criteria in all cases. So that has two implications. One is that there is a trade-off between different concepts of fairness. And the second one is which trade-off do we accept and which concept of fairness to apply in any given social situation or decision-making process is not a technological problem. Well, we have to implement it in the last stage, but this is rather a social and political one. And there are some suggested approaches on how to deal with this kind of problems. We have the high-level legislations, that is kind of the normative frameworks for that, from the Human Rights Convention to EU treaties that contain some aspects, and up to the GDPR that tries to be a bit more specific. Then you have privacy impact assessments and algorithmic impact assessments proposed. We have algorithmic auditing proposed that would look into the system itself. And then, of course, we can always hope for additional technological advances in machine learning techniques or in data pre-processing. And to finally sum up, there are actually three dimensions that are relevant for us as practitioners. And the first one is the ethics of data, with issues posed by the collection and analysis of large data sets, for example, in the biomedical domain, social and behavioral microdata. And those issues here are mostly of privacy and discrimination nature. Then we have ethics of algorithms, issues posed by the increasing complexity and autonomy of algorithms in the very broadest sense. And this concerns the responsibilities and accountabilities for unforeseen and undesirable consequences. And then we have the ethics of practices, issues concerning the responsibilities and liabilities of people and organizations in charge of data processes, strategies, and policies. This is perhaps also a very broad, a very soft definition. But here the main issues are consent, user privacy, and secondary use. But in most cases, only one definition is concerned. And what I try to do here is show that once we apply it, we can of course only look at the technology, we can look at the legal framework, but we need some kind of conceptual framework how to deal with all these different issues. And those kind of conceptual and analytical frameworks of how to set up algorithmic systems, what issues, at which stage of the implementation, of the design, of the actual use in production, do we have to consider when we want to run this the system in the best way possible, given some normative criteria that we set out for ourselves. And as a sneak preview in one of the next knowledge feeds, we will have a focus on fairness and transparency in automated decision makings. In more detail, we will look at, for example, how fairness can be quantified, how we can evaluate different properties of it, and also what current technologies are at the stage of research that promise to be able to be at the same time fair, keep some kind of privacy of the individual, and still be useful in the sense of classical accuracy. Yeah, that's it. I hope I was brief enough. The reference you can have here. Thanks.
Questions?
Just logistically, you're going to post your slides in the meetup so that we can look at the references?
Yep.
Yeah. So maybe I didn't get it right. The case before when you had black and white and recidivism?
Yes.
So you basically say that you have to decide here between, I'm just trying to between accuracy and fairness?
No, there are actually two different criteria for fairness that you have to trade off here.
Okay.
The first one is that you want the same accuracy for both groups, that you don't want the system to distinguish in itself on the sensitive category of race. It could be also sex, for example, in some kind of insurance decision. So you have a protected category, and you don't want the system to make any inherent decision on that.
Mm-hmm.
The second definition is that you have the same average assessment of individuals in the same class. And because the base rates between the different classes for medium and high, between the different groups is different, you cannot achieve this criteria if you want to keep the first one. You can achieve the second criteria, but then you would you would see a different behavior for the first criteria that demands that you don't differ between those.
So basically by deleting the race, you are having a trade-off, basically.
Yes, exactly.
But is then the prediction quality lower or almost the same?
I'm not sure it is about prediction quality, so accuracy. It's about being insensitive to a certain attribute.
Yeah, but in the end, you want to make a good prediction.
Yes.
So if you
but your target does not have an quantifiable accuracy. It's not like that guy who got a 6 on this score was a true 6 on that score. That's not the quantifiable metric. I mean,
yeah,
you can
see the David, that it's a quite quantitative.
Yeah, there is some link with some numbers, and you can expect that, for example, to be growing, but not at which rate and what constitutes which number. So that's arbitrary, and for that, it's difficult.
No, I think recidivity. So if a person,
yeah, sure, but
does
but the number you get is this risk score, and 1 does not mean 0% chance,
clear,
and
that's
10 does
that
not
is,
mean
that's
100.
Clear. But the target is clear to model that, and if you model, you can make a statement about accuracy, and you can define, okay, if I use these predictors, I get a more accurate model or not.
Yeah, but there was never talk about the model of the actual recidivity. It was just about what this score means.
It's not about accuracy, but whether you hit the true values better or worse. What their argument is, and also why the issue was so contentious between the two public debates, is it now biased against blacks or not, is that if we look at this metric, it is not biased because it treats both groups the same. People belonging to either group, if they have a higher chance of recidivism, they receive a higher risk score. So that's perfectly okay. The problem was that because of those two different base grades, people of African American descent received proportionately higher risk score than was actually the case, while white people received a disproportionately lower risk score than was actually the case. And only in the case that the base rates look the same for medium and high risk people, only then the differences would disappear.
Is it basically a, I try to explain it differently, basically in one case you decide to model a specific group correctly?
Yes.
Or more correctly? On the other side, you try to maximize the accuracy over both groups.
Yes, exactly.
Is this the trade-off, basically?
You either can optimize for the accuracy across groups.
Exactly, both you take it together, or for each specific group. Yes. So in one case, you might have 50% for accuracy for both.
Yes. Or
in the other case, 70-30.
Or you look at the average of the class you want to predict.
Sorry, I was just wondering, in the second case, would you say actually the blacks have a higher false positive rate? And so that's why it's being unfair? So a black person would be judged by the algorithm to be more likely, you would more often judge a black person to be...
In that case, it's a higher false positive rate, yes.
Yeah, so... Is that what we're looking at in the second situation? A higher false positive rate?
So the second situation is only the base rates. It doesn't show anything about the predictions. If the predictions are in the first graph.
So the risk category, isn't that what the model is predicting?
Yes, but this is, yeah, but this only shows the base rates.
So what do you mean by base rate then?
How the categories are distributed in the sample state that they were looking at.
That's the a priori probability, right?
Yes. This is what has been observed. Because the base rates are so different in the different classes, this is why the algorithm has results in a different treatment of high-risk black and high-risk white.
How are the risk categories assigned then? Who decides what's low and what's medium?
That I would have to look up. This is what has been in the data set, and I think this is some assessment that the judicial system makes in the US.
Do you have an EU current example instead of using the US black and white? Is there something going on here in the EU where you collect data on people's race?
That's why I was referring to them as algorithmic war stories, because I'm not actually aware of any issues of the same scale and impact in Europe at the moment. Of course, because most of the cases are producing the S, which is a kind of more liberal stance to experimenting with technologies, and then only after something happens to develop some regulation for that.
So then people that are of Syrian descent that have come in, you know, escaping their country here are not being tracked, and this information is not being gathered, there's no knowledge about this new entry into the EU. I'm just asking because I read the press and all I hear is that Europe is going to shit. And I'm here and it's not.
Good news, Faisal.
although I think we're all quite happy to be here.
I am here, truthfully.
Is this? I can only speculate because I haven't tracked those kind of issues versus those as you do. I think they are collecting data in some sense, but what is happening with it is not something that I have access to.
Maybe one similar thing, which was already regulated, and this was already mentioned today, there was a big issue about sex and insurance. So insurances normally tended to treat women and men differently because men have a higher risk behavior than women, and this is easily quantifiable.
Yeah,
it is very easily quantifiable, believe me. Especially under 35, it's crazy. But the thing is, it was explicitly forbidden to do that, which basically meant that the rates for women went up, which is like that. It's a decision that the society makes.
So the women have to pay for the men's.
Yeah, exactly. For example, this was discrimination, because it was said, okay, men are discriminated, they are treated more badly than women, which was right, but they were treated because of quantifiable data.
So now everybody is happy because everybody is paying.
No, but seriously, isn't everyone contributing to this part better than, for example, some people take health insurance, some people who are obviously more prone, for example, to forget to become sick, who wouldn't be able to.
Just
talking
about the resolution, what happens afterwards? Yes, they found this because they could also lower the men's part and raise a little bit the women's part. But if I see, it's very easy just then to bring up prices for everybody.
Which is still the question, if one should do that just because a company decides to do kind of the wrong thing from a natural person's point of view.
I don't think these issues are unique. I mean, you know, In the States, for instance, health insurance rates went up because men and women were treated differently, exactly that issue, because women get pregnant and need childcare, and that was discriminatory and it was outlawed. So, I mean, societies deal with this issue all the time. So now you can discriminate based on age, but you can't discriminate based on target condition or sex.
Very, very interesting. Here, I think here, just maybe to add that there is a very good tidbit about that in terms of race and let's say a lot of countries, it's that if you outlaw, for example, race, and you take zip code, then for most of European countries, it wouldn't make a difference. But for a lot of other countries, it would, because the differentiation where you live is basically highly accurate in what race you are, for example. So you can alter that then as well, all correlated things. But this is an ongoing discussion. So, and it's a decision by society.